Age.
They were promised a new South Africa based on peace and equality. Now they're forced to live with rampant unemployment, corruption, and violence.
Please move back. Move back. This is now a country, so please move back.
My future is fucked up now. It's not right.
Let me just say we are a lost youth. No.
As the great man prepares for his end, where is his country headed? Welcome to Four Corners. By any measure of political leadership, Nelson Mandela was a giant of his century. His ultimately victorious stand against apartheid inspired people far beyond his own nation. It's worth reflecting on what apartheid did. Not only did it use violence ruthlessly to suppress black opposition to white-only rule, it crushed the spirit. Of South Africa's then 40 million people, more than 35 million were born without the right to vote and could not even occupy the same space as whites by right. Mandela came to power on a great surge of hope, but as he now fights his final battle, that hope is sadly dissipated. For millions of South Africans, his vision of freedom, equality and justice has been frittered away by his successors. Despite the country's immense mineral wealth, the gap between rich and poor is wider than ever. 18 million live on less than $2 a day, and one in every two young South Africans is out of work. Corruption is endemic. The government's Special Investigative Unit estimates that 25% of all public funds are gobbled up by it. And there's a new breed of public servants called tenderpreneurs, who funnel public contracts into their own or colleagues' companies, skimming off millions. President Jacob Zuma has been involved in scandal after scandal, and now the ruling ANC party has its very own massacre, right up there with the Sharpeville and Soweto legacies of apartheid. Matthew Carney reflects on the South Africa Nelson Mandela leaves behind.
More than anyone, Nelson Mandela has made modern-day South Africa. But his legacy of peace and equality has been damaged forever in the mining belt of Marikana, northeast of Johannesburg.
Is there a problem to film here?
No, there's no problem. Murder here, murder there.
The world's largest platinum mines operate here. It's wealth that's meant to benefit all South Africans. What happened here has betrayed Mandela's famous words he spoke at his trial before he was jailed for life in 1964 for opposing the apartheid government.
I have cherished the idea of a democratic and free society in which all persons will live together in harmony and with equal opportunities. It is an idea for which I hope to live for and to see realized. But my Lord, if it needs be, it is an idea for which I am prepared to die.
On the 16th of August last year, about 3,000 miners gathered at this spot in Marikana to demand a decent wage from the British platinum mining company Lonmin. They waited most of the day for a response. Golani Noenzus was one of the organisers of the strike.
Still,
orders were given by the government to end the strike, so rapid response police teams were sent in. Tensions were running high. A week of protests had already resulted in six miners and two policemen being killed. Tear gas was fired into the crowd of miners and a group fled towards police lines. Police say the miners had firearms and were ready to attack. In front of television cameras, the mainly black police opened fire. In all, 34 miners were killed that day and 78 wounded. It is the most violent clash between police and workers since the end of apartheid.
Yeah, I want to acknowledge that we are apartheid. This is the work we have done. We have been shopping. We have been buying. We have been doing. We have been apartheid. We have been doing. We have been doing. We have
Remarkably, Masolo Makgijiwana survived the initial burst of gunfire. He was hit in the hip and left for dead. This is him on the ground.
Is
that you there? Are you on the ground? Is that you on the ground there?
Yes, you shoot me.
So you got shot, you fell?
After checking, the police found that Masolo was still alive. In a claim that's been disputed, Masolo says he was turned over and shot six more times by a black policeman.
One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. My future is fucked up now. It's not right.
But most of the killings happened out of sight of the cameras near this small rocky outcrop 100 metres away. Many of the survivors of the first shootings came here to seek refuge. A policeman's mobile phone footage has emerged that suggests 22 were killed here, many of them shot in the back, most unarmed.
So where were you? Up here or...?
But the strikers' ordeal was not over. In the days after the massacre, 220 were arrested and charged with the murder of the two policemen.
Yeah,
well. Golani says he was tortured to extract a confession.
I forget plastic la. Balka baltela mans. Abeza alfaka balbambe lapha. Kwesayitil na mans. Balfake la enhloko. Bafika balfaka bambe la. Uthi angaphumi la mans.
Masolo too says he was intimidated and threatened while he was in hospital trying to recover.
Namagama, Puma, Gomapuisa, Manafika, Figata, this guy, he lay the Bulala Police. He lay the Banjo, he pet his bum. Kodogumacha to a figum come in Gondo, just Kalela, the Kalend, the Kalend, the Slal and the Sleely, Chechi, Pin, the Fikel on the Baikon. Aband, Bangayens in Dinge. Ngova Ben Bon, good in the appeal. Maningalasli temp.
The Marikana massacre shocked the nation and the world. It evoked powerful memories of apartheid massacres like Sharpeville in 1960, where white South African police opened fire on black protesters, killing 69. And the Soweto riots of 1976, where 500 were killed. The African National Congress, or ANC, fought for decades to free South Africa. Since 1994, they've been in government. But now it seems they were turning their guns on their own people.
So that's why spoke with ANC as
the ruling ANC government has been forced to set up a commission of inquiry into the massacre.
As a democratic country, security forces have got to be under control. That's why there's an investigation. And we called upon everybody, put the cameras, even all news people, show us all the angles, what happened here, count the bullets on the ground, who died. And there's an inquest, there's an inquiry. It's run by independent judges, it's there. So I think it's a turning point, a warning, that you're going the wrong way. It's a tragedy that should not have happened.
Whatever the Commission of Inquiry concludes, Marikana has highlighted the failure of the ANC's model of development. The country's massive mining wealth has not lifted the poor black majority out of poverty. Many of the miners and their families that work at Lonmin live here near Vonderkop. It's a sprawling shanty town of homemade tin shacks where thousands survive with no running water or sewerage and limited electricity. Zamika Nongu's husband was killed in the massacre. She's been left with six children to support.
Inhliziyo iyavulwa umuntu ayijonge. Hayi boni ngisebuhlungu kakhulu. Angabelieve ukuthi umyeni wami akekho. Angathi umyeni wami ukho lapha sabekwe khona. Kusazothiwa hayi mhlawumbe okanye ndizitshela uba ngamanye maxesha okanye okanye ngisalela ngazi angathi nje ndikwelinye ilizwe. Angabelieve ukuthi umyeni wami akekho.
Her friend Nonkulu Luko Nexande also lost her husband on that day, leaving her with two young children. Without their husbands, these women have little income and little hope of a future. They came from the Eastern Cape, one of the poorest provinces of South Africa, with a dream of a better life. These are the very people the liberation struggle was meant to help.
Government simthande okunje waphatha South Africa. ANC sithanda kakhulu mara ngoku. Ohlobo esibona ngalo. ANC akuna ayinasizo ukuthi kozibulala abantu bayo ebebe support ukuthi mayibe yiwe yohlala eParliament iparty lizwe. Ngabantu ababulele. Nathi ufana ukuthi usibulele asena ndaba nayo. Kuba akho nto senzele yona sibulalele kuphela.
Sithandaze. nako sekulungile masithanda ke baba kulungile sekulungile.
Now they just have each other and broken dreams. They don't know how they will survive. Soon they'll return to their homeland in the Eastern Cape, 1,000 kilometres to the south. Not much has changed here since apartheid. Underpaid black labour still powers the mines, and it's mainly the whites who own the industry and take the profits. The only difference is that a tiny black elite have joined the white elite on boards of companies. In the late 1990s, the ANC government struck a deal with business. They would keep labour cheap and stable in return for some black ownership. Many see this arrangement has been at the expense of poor black South Africans, while a few, like Tokyo Sekwale, have benefited.
The approach there was black economic empowerment, to let black people advance. I'm one of them, by the way. I went into business for quite some time in mining, in the financial services and so on. Is it the only solution? Certainly not. It is just one way. It is just a way of getting people into the ownership of companies. But that's not what we're trying to do, to get everybody to become a businessman.
But it seems to have only benefited for a few at this stage.
Naturally, I'll accept that. I'll accept that because the approach is you can't turn everybody into a shareholder in the country.
...27-year-old Pabalo Tekiso is not part of South Africa's wealthy elite.
Hey, my baby.
But he certainly prospered because of the new freedoms won by Mandela and the ANC.
Quick, I promise.
He's part of the growing black middle class.
Yes, my love.
And he's juggling a new baby and a successful career as a photographer. Pabalo came from the slums of Soweto.
I didn't even dream that I would stay in a place like this where you have your own space, you have your own house. I think a lot of people would... I mean, I hear my friends when they visit from Soweto, they think this is heaven.
Do you feel privileged in any sense?
I do feel privileged, even though I'm never satisfied with myself, so I want a bigger house than this. I don't want... I feel like this is okay for now with one child and a wife.
Okay, so Mare, you talk to the office, yeah, job for Muse Malano.
Pabalo is living in Rudaport. It was once the domain of whites, but the new black middle class is starting to move in.
Celia? Morning.
Yes. Morning.
Morning. How's morning. It? Cool.
So what have you got on your agenda today?
Pabalo is the chief photographer of a major national newspaper, The Saturday Star.
So I'll be going with Noni.
He's been part of an ANC strategy to increase black participation in all industries and professions.
Going for that. So we'll right. chat later. Cool. I'm just going to go with Noni.
All right.
Cool.
Okay.
Bye.
Okay.
When he got his job here, Pabalo was given preference over a white candidate who had a similar skill set. It's positive discrimination. Under apartheid, blacks were restricted to menial employment.
The system is trying to fix the mistakes of the past. So I can say yes, freedom helps in that regard, to say we are now free to become whatever we want, to get positions we want. As long as you are qualified, then we can do the job properly.
Pabalo retains a strong connection to his roots in Soweto. And Soweto holds a special place in the liberation struggle. On weekends, he visits his parents in the same house where he grew up.
Sanbonan, Sanbonan.
Hi.
Hi. How's it? How's it? Bab.
Okay, yeah.
Legai. Sharp, sharp, sharp.
Pabalo was brought up in a world vastly different to his parents.
How are you?
No. No, we are blessed.
Mm.
Under apartheid, many blacks were uprooted from Johannesburg in the 1950s and forced to resettle in what is now Soweto.
Oh, yeah, it's so nice to be together. I've been missing this moment.
Once you are black, you couldn't see anything to a white person. white person like now. If you see something is wrong, you just say yabas, yabas. The swear apartheid was not good. You were just like a slave that time. Yeah, it's just because you work hard.
Yeah.
Pabalo's parents were not active politically. His father, Solomon, worked hard all his life as a clerk, and his mother, Maria, studied long and hard to become a teacher. Together, they've instilled the values of education and ambition into their four sons, who all went to university and onto successful careers.
I used to tell them that, you know what? Education is your weapon. It's your weapon to brighter future. And I could not even elaborate further because I was a living testimony to them.
My chance. Let's keep on my chance. Easy, my chance. Hola. Mataf, Dering. Get on.
Later, Pabalo finds his Soweto friends sitting in the same place, in the same positions, largely unemployed.
You know, I'm hiding in the suburbs.
The reality is that opportunity and success only comes to a few. Pabalo made it out, but they didn't.
You are the one who benefited more than us from the Mandela legacy. So that's why you are living at the suburbs and we are still here. So maybe you can connect us with the right people at the right places. We will be like you, my friend.
Join you up there.
That's a tough one. So you're not choosing jobs, you just want any job?
No, any job. As long as I get paid.
First of all, you look at their family backgrounds. There's no one who works. No one can afford to take them to schools. If you can't afford education, you can't get a good job, which means you are uneducated, you are unemployable, so you are left with hustling, like they were saying. To be honest, I really feel sad because sometimes when I visit, they'll ask to wash my car just for me to pay them something. And that's really sad to see that I grew up with this guy. He's supposed to be something, but today he's begging me for 30 rands, I mean, really.
Pabalo does a lot of work in Soweto. He likes to highlight injustice. It's his way of giving back.
The kind of stories I'm gonna tell through my lens would be stories that will provoke emotion, stories that will provoke change, stories that will provoke action. I feel like there's a higher calling, there's a higher purpose why I'm in the job that I'm in. Because if we, those who have opportunities, do nothing about the injustices we see around us, then we are also at fault. We are to be blamed for what's happening around us. We cannot change all situations, but we can change some situations.
But the question is, why haven't there been more success stories for black South Africans? It is this man, the president of South Africa, Jacob Zuma, who has come to symbolise what's wrong with South Africa, endemic corruption. Almost daily, new corruption scandals emerge, and they go right to the top. One of the biggest centres around the small village of Nkandla, about 2 hours north of Durban. We went to investigate. This is President Jacob Zuma's private retirement home. It's more of a complex. 31 new buildings, a double helipad, underground bunkers, soccer fields, and a gym, to name a few of the features. It will house the president's four wives and his 20 children. People are outraged that 270 million rand, or about $30 million of state funds, has been used to build most of it.
We know that if we do not introduce higher levels of accountability right at the top, we will be fooling ourselves in thinking that corruption can be fought without addressing those who lead us.
President Zuma's supporters have tried to justify the spending on security grounds, but it goes well above any official allocation. The president already has three other official houses to conduct state business. Local residents don't see a problem. His gain is their gain. But the largesse stops in the next valley. There's no electricity or water here. President Zuma claims there was no inappropriate spending at Inkandla. However, recently released documents, many labelled top secret, suggest otherwise. This memo shows a request, later approved, to divert public funds to Zuma's house at Inkandla. It says,
request the approval to shift funds from the inner city regeneration program to fund a prestige capital project.
In a draft report, the project is deemed top secret because
these projects are further targeted by journalists in an attempt to discredit the government in general.
President Zuma has made possessing documents like these a crime that can be punished with a 10-year jail term. Remarkably, he's using a 1982 apartheid law, the Protection of Information Act, to do it. There have been no arrests so far. Bungi Malengini helped set up Corruption Watch, and in just 16 months, they've received 4,500 reports of corruption from the public and officials.
If we are losing billions to corruption, you can imagine what we could have done with that money. You can imagine the number of houses that could have been built. You can imagine, levels of employment improving. Basically, the cost is really in what is being denied to the poor.
This is a shanty town in Tembisa, on the northern fringes of the capital, Johannesburg. 20-year-old Morangao Mabitla has agreed to show us what life is like for the majority of poor black South Africans. In Tembisa, they've been living in these shacks for 14 years. On most of the tin sheds are these numbers, one from the year 2000 and the other from 2007. It means they're registered on the housing waiting list.
So for 14 years they've been promising?
Yeah. Always promises, promises, and nothing is done about it.
So do people get sick of it?
Yeah, we do.
So they come, what, just before elections and they do
this? Yeah, next year it's elections, so they'll be coming, a lot of them will be coming.
And putting numbers up and promising things.
Promising things that are never actually delivered.
A core promise of the ANC as a liberation movement and in government has always been to provide housing for the poor. But millions remain homeless.
But then, hey, what can we say? We've got no power over them, so they can do whatever they like with us, which is unfair because we're only human. All we need is simple basic needs like houses, a roof over our head, clothes and stuff like that, and water.
The people of Tembisa share communal taps, usually located in the dusty and dirty streets. Morangao comes here five or six times a day to fill up her bucket.
This is where I get water. People pee on the side and then we just get water on the side, and you can imagine the kind of germs we're exposed to. Yeah.
As a concession, the government put some portable toilets near a few of the shacks. A truck is meant to come here once a week to pump out the sewerage, but often it doesn't make it to Tembisa.
They obviously didn't come on Sunday, they didn't come yesterday, so they came today, and now they're draining the toilets out. It's disgusting, you can't even feel the smell, but then we're used to it, you know?
What concerns Morongao most is the lack of jobs. Officially, about one in two youths are unemployed, but here it's much more. There's little to do and many gamble to pass the time.
So how long do they gamble for?
It could take about the whole day, 24 hours sometimes, because even at night you can still hear them throwing dice, like, hey, pop, hey, hey, you know, making those noises.
Morongao and the youth of Tembisa are meant to be the born frees, a generation that has grown up under the new freedoms and opportunities Mandela and the ANC fought so hard for.
We are unemployed, so we are just there.
We call it the
Ludo, this one.
Do you think you'd like anything fixed or anything to change?
Like what? Fixed like what?
I don't know, I'm asking you. I don't know.
Moving from living shots,
yeah,
or...
Maybe, yeah.
You can't. Look how many shots are.
So you don't think you'll be able to move at all?
If you look back at the people from the back 1970s, those people knew what it was that they needed to do, and they did it. They fight against, they didn't fight against each other. They fight for as a group, you know, as a whole. They fight for better future, fight for whatever they believed in. But us, you know, we tend to judge, we discriminate, we are lost. Let me just say we are a lost youth, you know.
There is little hope of the lost youth getting out of Tembisa. Crime is rampant, and the proceeds are usually spent at the local tavern. Morongao says the youth have been liberated politically, but not economically. It's estimated 18 million South Africans live on less than $2 a day, and she blames President Zuma for that.
If President Zuma was to walk in here now, what would you tell him?
Could you please try and live up to your responsibilities and your promises that you made to the country as a whole? We're not asking much, but we're just asking to be recognized as few individuals. Even though we live in shacks, we stay human at the end of the day. So try and put your attention on us instead of putting attention in other or in less important things. Yeah. While I was just fixing her hair to get ready to school, she's going to school right now, so just have to make it beautiful and stylish.
To survive, Morongao has built a close network of friends around her.
I'm a hair psychologist or a hair therapist. If she's got troubles, she talks to me and I'm like, go on, talk, let it all out. Cry, girl, cry, cry. Let the steam off. Shout at me. You can do whatever you want. No, just to make yourself feel better. If you
Morongao finished high school last year with good grades and she wants to get a job or continue studies.
I can't believe he just did that to me. These days, it's not about what you have. It's about who you know. You know, if you know someone from somewhere, obviously you put in, that person will put in a good word for you and then you get through in life, you know. If you have money, you can buy anything. You know, they say money can buy anything.
But that's something Morongao and her family don't have.
I'm cooking dinner for Mom before she goes to work. It's called pap. It's not really that hard to make, but then you have to maintain it. It's an everyday dish in South Africa. For most black people, we eat this each and every day because it's filling.
Morangal lives in this shack with her mother Tobogo and her little brother and sister. Her father left a long time ago. Tobogo works 12 hours through the night at a laundry in central Johannesburg 7 days a week. She's saving up so Morangal can go to university or college. She's determined to see her daughter have a better life than what she has. Tobogo remembers the high hopes when Mandela became president. But now, the gap between rich and poor is wider than ever. More than anything, what keeps Morangal happy is her dancing. She's a member of Vukani, a dance troupe, and today they're performing in the streets of Tembisa.
You know, when you dance, when you commit yourself, you get a lot, you get away from many troubles.
And this performance of the Gumboot song is one of defiance. It's based on a protest song developed half a century ago by the black miners of South Africa in response to the harsh conditions in the mines.
Life in Tembisa goes on, but there's tension and frustration here. Most of the youth are jobless. Many feel the ANC has failed them, but they can't find any alternative party to take up their cause. It's places like this that will test the future stability of the country and be the biggest challenge to Mandela's legacy of peace and unity.
We wanted to put some questions to President Zuma, and we were told on Mandela Day, Nelson Mandela's 95th birthday, we'd get that opportunity. The president was in Pretoria handing over 15 houses to poor white families.
There must be houses, there must be comfort for all. And that's what we are committed to do. I'm very happy, really, to see you here. We will have houses even to those who are still waiting. When the program continues, they will get the houses. Today,
after nearly 20 years in power, the ANC says it's built 3 million houses with another 2 million planned.
And one.
But corruption and incompetence are undermining the program of renewal.
Thank you very much.
This is about as close as we got to putting questions to the president.
Mr. President, from ABC Television. Congratulations on Mandela Day. Congratulations.
Thank you.
What do you think's been achieved, sir?
Mandela Day.
Tokyo Sekwali was Minister for Human Settlements for 4 years. Last month, President Zuma removed him because he was seen as a rival for the top job.
A government which is confronted with a lot of difficulties and challenges around education, health, poverty and so on, these issues have got to be addressed. And I think we're getting there, but there are problems, and we must admit where there are. Not policy problems, because the policies are in place, but implementation and making sure that people are held accountable to what they're supposed to be doing.
In the absence of interim funding, the application for a postponement will be heard on, decided on Monday.
And the biggest accountability test for the ANC government is the Commission of Inquiry into the Marikana Mine Massacre.
The order we make is that the sitting of the commission will be adjourned.
So far, the commission, which has been sitting for 10 months, has been dogged by delays and false starts.
It would be a huge disgrace, it would be a huge loss. If the commission, for example, was to stop its work, I don't know what will happen.
The commission has heard compelling evidence against the police actions. These pictures show how the police planted false evidence to try and justify the killings by placing weapons beside the dead for the official police photos, when photos taken earlier by the media show no weapons present. The widows and their lawyers are seriously concerned that the miners are going to have their legal funding cut by the government. And if that happens, they'll boycott the commission. It's also proving to be dangerous to be a witness at the Marikana Commission. Six miners have been murdered just before they were to take the stand.
You know, crucial potential witnesses kept on dying. Unfortunately, we cannot, as legal people, pin it on any of the parties. But it is disturbing. It is disturbing to an extent that one of our advocates was also stabbed. And it was somehow suspected that it was linked to the commission itself.
There's little faith in the commission. Currently in South Africa, about 9,000 police officers face criminal charges such as rape, corruption and assault, but less than 100 have ever been convicted. For many in this country, the ANC has lost its vision and moral authority.
I don't see good education system, I don't see better health system, I don't see anything new that's coming up that's positive. And I think we either need change of leadership in the ANC or we need a new party that can take the country into a different direction, because I don't think where we are at the moment, the ruling party can handle the mess that's happening.
In the shanty towns of South Africa, and indeed the rest of the country, there is still energy and vibrancy, despite all the hardships. The challenge for the ANC government is to harness that passion and drive and use it to direct change. The current leadership only has a short opening to prove to the people that it can deliver results and honour the legacy of Mandela. For the Freedom Generation are looking for a new revolution.
Perhaps Nelson Mandela's greatest gift to his nation was to find a peaceful path out of apartheid. And when he goes, the world will celebrate a great life and deeply mourn his death. But sadly, there's a lot more to mourn than the passing of a great man. Next week on Four Corners, an extraordinary tale of one woman's search for her childhood friend caught up in the horrors of Zimbabwe's violent civil conflict. Until then, good night.
You can watch tonight's program again on iView or see more of our research and interviews at abc.net.au/fourcorners.